Good afternoon, everyone in Dubai, and welcome to the last webinar. Thank you for joining this opportunity. Thank you for joining today. I just share my screen and then we'll get started. So can you see my screen? I'll begin by talking to you all about the exponential opportunity. If there are questions, put them in the chat. I have budgeted around 45 minutes for conversation and 15 minutes for Q&A. And if we see a lot of questions, then we may stop earlier and take questions. I think the value is in the questions and the conversation we have there. So the exponential opportunity, just to talk about this for a minute. So there are two words, you know, this is all that I'm going to talk today is from a book by Salim Ismail, which is called Exponential Organization. I don't know, some of you may have read it or heard about it. A lot of the framing comes from there. So as the webinar teaser said, how do you make organizations grow 10x faster, cheaper, better? All these new age companies which started, you know, in the 21st century, some of them, you know, 6 months, 15 months ago, and then they go on to become unicorns, a unicorn being a company whose valuation is $1 billion, a year, 2 years, 5 years, and so many of them happening all over the world, including in the UAE. Are they just be lucky? Is there some method behind the madness? Is there a secret sauce? And the answer based on research is that yes, there is some secret sauce. So we will give you a little context on what the opportunity is and what happens and what are some of the elements that go into making an organization of this nature. Okay, so first let's begin. I would like to talk about the word organization. Organization, the concept itself is like a 5,000 year old word. The army was the original organization, you know, Alexander and the Greeks and the Romans had armies. And that army organization concept was a command and control mindset. And based on scarcity, the command and control mindset has continued into the 21st century. And even today, many organizations are command and control. Exponential organizations are not. What is the opposite of the word scarcity? Abundance. So the exponential organization practices a mindset of abundance. This is easy to say. This is simple to say, not easy to do. Let me give you examples of how the new age organizations practice abundance. A Uber driver will also be driving Kareem or Lyft or Ola, depending on which part of the world you are in. And yet neither Uber nor Ola or Lyft care about it. Can you imagine a city banker working in Bank of America or somebody in Coke working in Pepsi? We just don't get it. I mean, you know, we can't comprehend that. The first thing is I can work for you and for your competitor. The second part is nobody's checking in on me. What time I come to work? What time I sign out? That is abundance, right? That is the practice of abundance at the, let's say, employment level. Another example could be at the, you know, competition level. For example, Google will collaborate with Apple and with Microsoft. On an Apple phone, you will see Google Maps, Microsoft products available. So collaborating with the enemy, competition and all is actually operationalizing abundance. So I just talked about the journey that this exponential organizations need to do from scarcity into abundance at the mindset and practice level. My employee can work for competition, he can work part-time, he does not need to be an employee, etc., etc. Just some examples of that. The next word to explain is exponential. Okay, so if we take 30 linear steps, you know, and each step is a meter, then at the end of 30 meters, at the end of 30 steps, I'll be 30 meters away. If I took 30 exponential steps, which is really doubling, I mean, that's an approximation. You know, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, at the end of 30 steps, we would be 27 times around the earth, 28 times around the earth. You may have heard this and you would say, yeah, I've heard this, you know, and we would have heard stories in our childhood of, you know, on a chessboard, I think they are wanting to give grains of rice and one grain on the first square and two on the second. And by the time it will reach the 20th or 30th, so there's not enough grain in the granary to, you know, populate that. So we've heard this, but what's the part we miss? The part we miss is that for 15 steps, not even 0.01% of the journey is done. At the end of 20 steps, not even 1%, 0.1% of the journey is done. And 97% of the journey happens in the last five steps. So whenever there's exponential growth, and COVID is a good example, we go through three phases. The first phase is called deceptive, where we tend to be dismissive, like COVID started and people said, oh, Wuhan, these Chinese eat bats, etc., and all of that. We tend to be dismissive. And that goes on for a long time. You have to be patient through the things. But important thing is to see if the doubling is happening. Deceptive. The next stage is gradual, which is, let's say, in this example, from steps 22 to 25, when you begin to take notice of it, and then suddenly. And we've seen that play out in the COVID world. COVID is a good example of exponential growth. The other, what else is growing exponentially? The other thing that is growing exponentially is data. You know, we all know how, you know, that there's more data every day now. You know, we hear these things about data happening so much. More than the first 2,000 years of human history and all of that. So that's another thing that's growing. But the question is, A, can I access it? Can I make sense of it? And can I use it to my organizational business advantage? So that's the explanation from of exponential and organization. So when we look at it graphically, the way we position it is that there's a deceptive phase where linear tends to be done, and we companies tend to get impatient, companies tend to be dismissive, and we think it's too expensive, and we tend to ignore it. And then suddenly, at the point at which the exponential line crosses the linear line is called the knee of the curve. And then suddenly, all these things begin to happen. I want to introduce the next. So I've explained to you organization, and I've explained to you exponential. I want to bring one third concept, and then I'll get into the framing of this. The third concept that I want to talk about is exponential technologies. What is an exponential technology? The original exponential technology that we are familiar with was what was called Moore's Law. Gordon Moore, one of the co-founders of Intel, had said that the computing power of a microprocessor doubles every, would double every 18 months, and the price would halve. And the cycle, so any technology whose performance doubles and the price halves, and the cycle time, and this happens thrice, is dubbed an exponential technology. So computing power, Moore laws have come. Gordon Moore had said this in 1965, and I think 2015 or so, we celebrate 50 years of the Moore law and counting. But, you know, we were able to see that even before that, before the chip came and before the transistor came, extrapolating just the computing thing from vacuum fluid and real electromechanical, really this exponential law has been 100 plus years in the making, right? So for the first time in mankind, so we are living at a Gutenberg moment. What is a Gutenberg? I mean, the Gutenberg was the person who found the printing press, and the printing press fundamentally revolutionized society and the world, because earlier all scriptures and everything were transmitted by word of mouth and things like that. The printing press started that. That was called the Gutenberg moment. Today, we are living on at least 20 exponential technologies, which we call, 20 such Gutenberg moments. So what are these technologies? Okay, 3D printing, artificial intelligence, blockchain, biotechnology, augmented reality, virtual reality, robotics, nanotechnology, quantum computing, solar, drones. Just to give you an example of drones, why are they called exponential? The amount of weight, a drone's performance is measured by the weight it carries. The amount of weight a drone carries has been doubling. It started out in the toy industry. Today you have drones which can commercially carry 100 kilograms. And this performance is doubling and the price is halving. Similarly, solar energy you could pick up. So all of these things, the performance is doubling, but whichever way we measure performance, and the prices have halving. And many of them are near the knee of the curve, which is gradual, part. And therefore, things are going to be much better than we think. For example, in the next 10 years, water will be nearly free, energy will be really free, and healthcare will be nearly free. Let me give the example of water. We hear of what water scarcity, but 3/4 of the world is water. What is expensive is the cost of technology to convert desalination into drinkable water. That technology is growing exponentially, which means it's becoming cheaper and better. So just to give an example, similarly on solar, right? Progressively, the price of things, seen that happening in our lifetimes. For some of the older people, mobile phones is a good example and their price points. So just to give you an example, disruption happens much faster than you think. This is 13 years apart, the same place on New York, Fifth Avenue, New York. On Easter morning, they found on Easter morning, there's one car here, which is circled, and mainly horse carriages. The New York mayor's main problem was, how do we, the amount of horse shit on the street, how do we, later, there's one horse there and I can't find it. So, you know, that's how these things move much faster than we think. The other point I want to make is experts, like all of us, are trained to think linear. Thinking exponential, the human mind is not able to easily embrace a concept like, and here's from 2009, consistently for the last 11 years, every year, the World Economic Forum outlook, the International Energy Association's outlook has been consistently wrong. That the red bolt line is the actual performance of renewable energy in the world. And those are the projections year on year. The lightest line at the bottom being 2009, even 2020, they've been getting it wrong. So that's really what's happening. Just to tell you how experts often don't get it right, because all our projections, we tend to do linear. Okay. The other thing I wanted to say to you is that not only are these technologies exponential, they're also converging. For example, we would have expected the flying car to come either from the flying industry, automobile industry, or the aeronautical industry. It actually is coming out from the toy industry where drones and others were invented. And so, for example, the flying car has existed, and there was a helicopter, which is kind of close to a flying car, but still we weren't getting there. Why? The main issue was the noise and the propellers of the helicopter and how much sound they make. Today, using LiDAR technology and distributed electric propulsion, you can take hundreds of micromotors, synchronize them, and they provide enough lift to do that. And they don't make noise. They make noise like a buzzing ant or something like that. That plus 3D printing, plus LiDAR, solar-rated batteries, nanotechnology materials, all this will converge to give you a flying car. And we expect the flying car to come by the next year into commercial availability. Places like Dubai and all have already started announced flying taxi services and all of that. And all of these technologies, just to give you a flavor, I've got the price points here. So what was $40,000 in 2007 is now $20 in 2021. The 3D technologies is one. Industrial robots are now available for commercial production at $5,000. This is $500,000 13 years ago. Drones. Let me talk about drones for a minute. So to give you a sense of disruption. So I've introduced 3-4 concepts so far. One is organizations and the journey from scarcity to abundance. Second is exponential doubling, which 96% of the journey happens in the last 4-5 steps. The third is exponential technologies, where the performance doubles and the price halves and cycle repeats thrice. Today, there are 20 of them. The thing I want to mention here is technology does not disrupt. It is naive to believe technology disrupts. It is the business model which disrupts. For example, video streaming technology existed for a long time, you know, Skype and other things, almost 15 years. But Zoom came and disrupted the airline industry, and all projections are that business travel will degrow 40%. The largest, single largest sector is business travel, and that will degrow 40% in the next, going forward. Similarly, Let's say Google Maps, you know, but it disrupted thick companies like TomTom and SatNav and all of that, and by giving it away for free. Netflix, video streaming existed for a long time. Netflix disrupted competition. So technology does not disrupt. The way you deploy it, you know, Airbnb or Uber are examples of the way they use technology to business models to disrupt using technology. And let me tell you how disruptive this can be. I don't know if you're aware. I live in India, and in Sri Lanka is making a port using Chinese aid, with the help of Chinese aid, and lots of concern about security of the Indian Ocean and all going on. Salim Ismail, the founder of Exponential, was there last quarter in Sri Lanka, and he told the Prime Minister of Sri Lanka that in the 7 years and so many billion dollars you take to make a port, four drones will be able to pick up a container from the ocean and bring it to the shore or even to the warehouse. Why are you building a port? How disruptive is that? And this is not science fiction, or this is not astrology. This is just the exponential thing, the doubling and price halving every 3 years. Just to give you an example of how disruptive these things are on the brink of. Solar energy, I talked to you about. How much has come down. Sensor, the number of sensors that we have and the kinds, like different kinds, all of them prices coming down, and that is the heart of Internet of Things or IoT. Okay, brain computer interface devices are growing so much, and nanotech, graphene, the prices have dropped. These are some examples to give you of the kind of prices that are dropping. Genome sequencing, what to cost? $10,000 is now available for, this data is of 2014. In 21, it's available for $100 and declining. So we'll be able to customize medication to a unit of one. We are on the brink of that. Ray Kurzweil, Peter Diamantis, and Salim Ismail were the three co-founders of the Singularity University. The concept of Singularity was that technologies will converge, and like philosophy, there'll be one grand unification and whole. So therefore, Singularity as a vision or a goal. And Ray Kurzweil said that we are about to see 20,000 years of technological progress in just 100 years. In fact, in 10, we've seen so much. Now, I just want to tell you, how did this journey happen? Okay, there are six stages in which of disruption. The starting point is digitization. We have a product or a service or something which is happening in a physical form, like we're checking the temperature of something and recording it somewhere, or we're checking the pressure or the color or the distance or the vibration or any of those things. We have to be able to do that digitally. Like we would take photographs on a film, now we have to take photographs digitally. So first part is digitization. Now, when you digitize it, it'll be clunky, slow, people will be dismissive of it. And that's when we go through the deceptive phase, and many technologies enter the deceptive phase. Then suddenly one day it'll come out and it'll disrupt, you know, because it'll have reached a place where it is so, sorry. We'll reach a place where it'll, begin to break everything. Then it will get to a scale where it can be, it makes even economic sense to offer something for free. Like Google will offer maps for free. Somebody will offer you a service at the entry level for free to induce consumption. So we take money out of the equation, it's demonetized. And I often ask my clients, what would you do if somebody offered your product or service for free? And clients are stunned by the question and they don't know how to go about that. The next thing is dematerialize. It is, you know, it's available digitally. It can be transmitted. You don't need a warehouse. You don't need logistics. And with that, we get to the final stage where it's accessible and available, which we call democratization. And any technology, I mean, let's say the phone photographs or cameras or video. Remember, we used to go around with that. Now, even a poor man has it and is able to share that with that. So those are the six stages that are necessary that are followed in the disruption journey. Just to give you a visual thing of dematerialization. Some of you may have seen this video. It's been there on LinkedIn and other places for a while. I'll move on. So this decade is going to be, the 21st century is going to be, really, really remarkable. Lots of opportunities for innovators. You know, you might read this book called Future is Faster Than You Think. Future is indeed better also than we think, largely because technology, while it may have so many disadvantages, is really one of the big tools and levers for the world being a better place. So this is the counterintuitive truth. Like, we have seen companies like GE and others kind of fall apart and all of that, largely because of not being able to embrace the abundance mindset and all of that. The other thing I want to mention to you is that the time companies are taking to become, on the left-hand side, I plotted a typical Fortune company would take 20 years to get to $1 billion valuation. And now we have companies doing it less than 2 years and a year in 2012. In 2021, I have a similar slide, not for 1 billion market cap, but for 10 billion market cap. So this is happening far more rampantly and is getting compressed and cramped far more dramatically. Just to give you an example, in 2019, Tesla was the fourth largest company, automobile company by value. And in 1 year during COVID, the Tesla's market cap was more than the top 10 auto manufacturers combined. That is disruptive because Tesla is a truly exponential company, again, disrupting the world. In fact, about Tesla, I have a friend who told me the story that they would drive every time from, from Canada, like from Ontario till Florida. In 2018, they used a Tesla and 20% of the journey, was on autonomous driving, self-drive. And by 2019, December, a year later, 60% of the journey was autonomous. When we ask people, what is Tesla? Some people will say it's a car with a computer. Then they say, actually, it's a computer with wheels. Actually, Tesla is an app with wheels. Why do I say that? Tesla refreshes once every 48 hours. The app refreshes and updates every 48 hours. So that's how, for us to be able to frame that it's not a car, but an app. And can you imagine the agility and the data and they're used to keep refining and improving the car. The other thing I want to mention is all of these things are both the velocity and incentive intensity of these shifts is increasing. Kodak took 100 years, went down quickly. Record companies who took 40 years to build went down in 5 years. Blockbuster took 19, came down very quickly with the invent. So the crash and demises are happening much, much faster of older economy companies. At the same time that Kodak was going bankrupt from a market cap of 28 billion, Instagram was for 13 employees sold for a market cap of 1 billion, right? With 13 employees. So that's what we're calling a Kodak moment. So why do we get disrupted? The main reason is we are focusing on competition, not the customer, right? And competition almost never disrupts us. Disruption comes from the edge of the side and we don't even see it. I'll skip this. I'll move on to that. Well, let me talk about this for a minute. Essentially, we now have a method in our exponential world of assessing the, like you have IQ and EQ, there's something called EXQ, which is exponential quotient. We are able to measure and give a score. So, the top 10 companies on exponential quotient here were these, and the top 10 companies on Fortune 500 were on the right-hand side. In a three-year time frame, these top 10 outperformed the group by 26% on the S&P, and the bottom 10 came down. This data is 2016. Recently, the 2020 data came out, and the top 10 EXU companies outperformed, and this is about to be published, outperformed the bottom 10 by a factor of 27. So the, even the performance, not 27%, by a factor of 27x. So that's how disruptive things are becoming. And as you know, I mean, what is the asset, right? The assets are no longer, you know, building and equipment and cash and bonds and inventory. The assets are patents, brand value, customer data. Those are the assets. And 90% of the valuation in 2020 is based on these intangible assets, whereas 83% was based on tangible assets, you know, let's say 40 years ago or so. So this is the digitization and disruption happening. So there are many examples of, we define exponential organization, one whose output is disproportionately 10x, not 10%, 20%, 30%, or, you know, 50%, 10x larger than its peers because of the use of innovative organizational techniques, business models that leverage those 10 or more exponential technologies that exist today. These are some examples. Local Motors is a good example. Local Motors crowdsources design from designer or automobile designers who work in their free time, and then manufactures them using people and their time. And everybody gets a share when the car sells. And it's now a $10 billion company. Okay. So here's what is an EX or exponential organization? So it must meet most of these criteria. The impact has to be 10x larger versus peers, faster, better, cheaper. To give an example, if Marriott Hotels had to add 100 rooms, it would cost them so many million dollars and maybe 18 months. Airbnb can add them in a minute. Many parts of the design business are digitized. These accelerating exponential technologies that we talked about, referred to, you leverage. Typically, it must deploy a new business model. It can be an app, it can be freemium, it can be a platform, it can be an ecosystem, any of those things. Decreases cost of demand, which means, you know, most of these things grow by word of mouth and, you know, peer getting peer kind of a thing. And similarly, cost of supply, people will use Airbnb because your friend told you to, rather than you saw an Airbnb ad or something in the old economy. Similarly, cost of demand, getting a new customer is becoming nearly free, and supplying to the customer is also becoming nearly free, right? For example, again, for Uber to add one more car to its fleet is nearly free. And it's usually a platform balancing out these communities. After all, the society is not ready, okay? Because society is thinking a scarcity, which is local. You know, 2000 years we spent, even the airplane, which kind of was the first thing to try and compress space, is like a 100-year-old thing, right? So for almost, for so many millennium, we have been local, linear, and present forward. Whereas in the abundant world, it's exponential, global, and future backward. Future backward, the example I gave you all of drones, the four drones being able to lift a container and bring it to the shore from an ocean liner is an example of future backward. Okay. And this abundance we will see in the physical space at Airbnb, in the human, I talked about local motors, and even in a digital space. So abundance will come and surround us in many ways. I'll skip this. Yeah. Okay. So after all this, I'll just talk about Salim Ismail studied companies between 2006 and 2014 and brought out edition one of the book Exponential Organization 2015, where he found that all these companies which became unicorns and deca-corns, including Google and all, there were 11 elements of this, 11 ingredients in the secret sauce to make an exponential organization. So the formula is really MTP, which I'll talk about in a minute, which stands for massive transformative purpose, which is one, which kind of holds everything together. And then An acronym called scale, S-C-A-L-E, I'll describe that, on how do we access and tap into abundance, and an acronym called ideas on how do we manage and navigate through the abundance. So that's roughly the idea. So MTP stands for Massive Transformative Purpose. Purpose is very important, and it is not like, you know, we've all seen companies have vision statements, and you say this is another such phrase. But, you know, vision statements normally go like, you know, we'll be the most preferred this, or we'll be the leading that, or we'll be the most admired that, and we'll be, but it's all about me, I, me, myself, and my company. Whereas purpose is actually beyond self and beyond the organization. Example, Google's purpose is organize the world's information. Tesla's purpose is accelerate the world's adoption of renewable energy. Okay, to give a, I can give more. So now, how do we access abundance? We access abundance through these five things on the right, which is, staff on demand. We've seen, right, most of these companies, like whether it's Zomato or, you know, or any of these companies, Uber and all, they will have staff on demand. You use them when you need them, and you pay them on a pay-per-use basis. Community and crowd. Communities, people who are broadly connected with you directly, like could be vendors and customers and people in the community. Crowd is going beyond that. Crowd, like, you know, you would have seen the number of people who will tell you to buy an iPhone. So it is the crowd actually endorsing the, maybe, you know, the fact that they're bringing cool designs and cool product experiences to a world. So let me give an example of crowdsourcing, in the world. You may have heard of a company called Xiaomi. Xiaomi is, it shuttles between being the number one mobile company in the world, smartphone company in the world in terms of sales, and number two. It was briefly number one, I think, is slipping to number two. But Xiaomi does not have any, what you call, zero product development team. In their product development, how do they do that? They have three communities, online communities, one for the low-end phone, one for the mid, and one for the high-end. And these communities are full of geeks or people who are interested in phones and gadgets, who will keep saying, oh, we should have this megapixel and we should have that kind of feature. Then they vote. And what is the reward for this community? They get the phone for beta testing 6 months before you and I see it in the market. For 6,000 phones, zero department for product development, and edgy and localized to different countries. Algorithms, you almost have heard a lot about algorithms, and anything which is routine and repetitive, there are ways of automating that. Leveraged assets is, I have a spare bedroom in my house and you need a bedroom for the night. So marrying unmet need with unused resource. So that's a leveraged asset. Let me give an example of leveraged asset, how we can do this. So there's this famous project called the Curitiba project, which is in Brazil in the 70s. Brazil, a food surplus country, but corrupt and poor, and people dying of starvation and all. So the mayor of Curitiba, what he did was he decided that a bag of garbage would be considered to be of value. So a child would carry three bags of garbage, on way to school. One garbage bag would be the bus ticket. One garbage bag would be the midday meal. One garbage bag would be the school fees. With this, three, four things happened. The garbage, instead of collecting outside the house and making the slums dirtier and the roads blocked so that the buses and vehicles could not come into that, now it went either to the bus depots or to the schools from where it was easier to do it. And it set the whole economy and the community, developing on the journey. But just by marrying unmet need with unused resource. Engagement is, how do we engage the community and the crowd and the customer? So gamification, incentives. When you get down from a Uber or a Kareem, the guy will tell you, sir, can you give me five a rating of Uber? And that kind of engagement is what we're talking about. So these are five elements of how do we access abundance. Then we need to, we've tapped into the abundance. Now, how do we manage it? That's an acronym called ideas. I stands for interfaces. We need a pipe to bring it all in. And then dashboards. Dashboard in management parlance is often used in the boardroom or for internal meetings and internal things. This snow melts at the edge, not the core is a common saying. So dashboard is, let's say a Uber driver can see on his app that, you know, his passenger is 13 minutes away and he has to drop off another passenger and pick that up, and he sees his incentive and the money coming in, all of that. That's a dashboard. Real time on the edge. Experimentation, fail fast, fail cheap, get quick feedback loops and then feed forward. Need to do, for to be able to do experimentation, autonomy, abundance, leaving people alone, not command and control. And we help companies go on this exponential journey. And the main challenge is in letting go on abundance, you know, on autonomy, and allowing experimentation and failure. And the final one is social technologies, social technologies are things like Slack and Yammer and Zoom and Google Docs and all of those things, which allow us to collaborate. So on the right hand side, we are able to get, you know, unlock creativity, growth amidst all the uncertainty. And on the left hand side, with our left brain, we try to bring some order, control and stability into that. So that's roughly the, you know, 11 elements of the secret sauce. If you're an existing company, it makes sense to start with at least 4 plus MTP. Without MTP, there's no going. So plus MTP. And if you are a new company, we must think aggressively of ways of incorporating all 11 initiatives around all 11 to do something about it. Okay. Here are some examples for actual MTPs. Of companies which are exponential. As I said, Google is organized the world's information. TED is ideas worth sharing. Boston Children's Hospital, until every child is well. Tesla accelerated the world's transition to sustainable energy. Quirky make invention possible. Quirky went down and came back, for people who may know. World top 20 project, educate every child on the planet. Interpredations, the Mexican insurance company, simply solving humanity's risks. So just to give you visually, you know, we talk about mission statements and vision statements. There is a destination, there is a mission on the road, but why are we undertaking? The why is the important. Simonson talks about why. And alongside that, the values, you know, you'll see a lot of like do no evil or something like that, I think is one of the credos at Google. And then you assign personal. So, this is just a graphic representation. Yeah, so my colleagues Zahira on the call, me and Payal, we help companies in the Middle East and South Asia to do that. And now we're supported by a large ecosystem of 8,000 people, exponential technology experts, business model gurus, people familiar with the technology and the platform. So we can drag and drop them, you know, to help us on a pay-per-use basis rather than, you know, on a staff on demand, if you wish, basis, bring in the advice to help companies go on this journey. Final check-in. If your business, if you're not kind of consumed with daily, you know, survival issues, if you're able to take a break from survival, and survival is not a challenge, then we suggest you think EXO. You will find early warning signals, which you're not able to explain. Why is this happening? Why are we losing share? Why is the price going down? Signals are the data of the future, and to be very careful and mindful of that. I ask owners of companies, how often do you read signals and respect? Hey, why is happening? What's going on here? And alternately, if we got kicked up, a lot of our mindset and inertia comes from out of fear, out of familiarity and, you know, things. So I often ask them, if we got kicked out of leadership, what would new leadership do? They often know the answer. And then I say, why don't we begin with that? So with that, I'm done. I can stop sharing and I can take questions. Would anybody like, are there any questions in chat or anything that I could do? No, I don't know. I'm not an expert. Sam, I don't know. I seen your question. I'm not an expert. I mean, I will tell you what I've read and not. I don't have insightful comment on that.
I mean, I can make a quick comment on metaverse. This is Varun Malik. You know, it's nowadays the meeting that we're having in Zoom, for example, today, you know, we're sitting face to face with each other, right? And I'm going to like talk basic, of course, but we're sitting face to face to each other, right? And some of us are on video and some are not. But the idea of the metaverse is that this is not naturally how humans engage with each other. So the idea is that we engage with each other in a virtual world, but like we do in the physical world. So I think that's the basic concept. Obviously, it's done using a combination of VR and AR and something called XR, which is mixed reality. Obviously, there are questions in terms of whether VR and the metaverse is actually the future of virtual collaboration, or is it something else, right? Is it XR, which is mixed reality, or is it more AR, where you're engaging with people and objects and around you in augmented reality rather than just virtually, right? I know what it is about. Sorry. So my question is, would we be moving exponentially by converting life? I mean, I can say this at least, and maybe Jyoti might have another comment on that, but I can say that it is potentially an exponential technology. It is not something which is, you know, the metaverse has just been introduced over 3-4 years ago. Of course, Facebook has made it big by getting into it. But is it indeed going to be an exponential technology that changes life? I mean, that's a trillion dollar question that will be answered in the coming years.
Sam and others, I just want to say that if you're interested from our EXO community, we can arrange a session by some leading guru on a metaverse, but I will not be able to.
Jyoti, there's another question by, but just to close out on Sam's, he's saying he read a book which is written in 2011, says a lot, thanks. And Abhay is asking, excellent examples from a non-product perspective. What advice, if any, would you have for an IT services company who may wish to embark on any EXO journey? Is it at all predictable?
Everybody, the train of, this is sounding cheeky, but I'll come back and give an example. So what we say is the train of disruption has left the station. There are three scenarios. Either you're on the train, or you're under the train, or you will watch the train fish past you, right? So even for example, do you have to hire people, or can you have competition so that experts, somebody does code? You'll see how some companies like Linux grew exponentially in a very nimble, light way, right? Do I need to, if it's scarcity, then I want to own and have the staff on my role and all the issues of attrition and retention and development and project management. Whereas progressively, a lot of work is happening, agile, staff on demand kind of a thing by introducing competition and then only paying up when my use case is addressed, as one example. If you go through all the exponential attributes, there's lots you can be doing in terms of engaging the community and the crowd. Not just in terms of the delivery, but even the dashboards at the customer end. Today we are so siloed in our IT architecture. You know, what is happening? So the question for you is, let's take banking or fintech. You know, all the banks with the legacy systems are never able to, we talk customer service, but because they put business at the center of it rather than the customer. It is we are very process centric, which is very different from being customer centric. Companies like Amazon and others, even local ones, the kind of experience they give because they are digital first. The latency and the fact that we need to bolt on and add on to our existing IT infrastructure comes in the process primacy rather than customer centricity is what comes in the way. I would suggest begin customer from a customer centric point of view as a starting point. What is the pain point of the customer? And can I go digital first in addressing it rather than find? So I would suggest start on the side. The main challenge in a company is, what is the main competition for EXO? The main competition for EXO is the immune system of the company, which kills any new idea. Example, Kodak and invented the digital phone, but did not put it under the carpet or drawer, whatever. Netflix was available to sale for Blockbuster, but Blockbuster board said no. 12% of our money we make from late fees, and that's among the reasons they said no to Netflix. So the framing is customer centric, not process primacy, and digital first in terms of beginning to address, experiment and address it. I don't know if I've answered your question. Just try to give some thoughts on that. Are there any questions, comments, concerns?
If there are no questions, maybe we could ask the participants to share what resonated with them. Is there any takeaway that you would like to share? You can come off mute and share. Anybody? Please feel free to unmute and share one takeaway you've had from today.
Or type it or whatever. Any other points? Are we good?
Okay, I guess if there are no other comments, we can call it a day. You can, of course, reach out to Jyoti. You have his email address now. And you can ask, reach out to me as well. I'll type my email address if you have any questions. And we're looking forward to seeing you at our next event. Perfect. Jyoti and my email addresses are in the chat.
Thank you, everyone. Feel free to reach out and thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone.